That take what, like half an hour till I get over there and get situated? That's a sixth of my sleep. I need that time. And we have a couch upstairs, yes, but it's 4 feet long. It has wooden arms. I need some place where I can stretch out and sleep. And I see my bed as this dry oasis in the sewage. I'm like, oh.
It's right. All right. Well, I hope you guys are enjoying the opening comedy there. You can check it out further. I'll post these slides later so you can check it out further. Now we're going to go ahead and get started. Welcome to the JSS Happy Hour. It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. Sunshine, she's here. You can take a break. I'm a hot air balloon that could go to space. Hope you all are having a great day. Welcome to the JSS Happy Hour. We're going to have a lot of fun today. We're going to learn a little bit about research. And for those of you that want, we're going to hang out a little afterwards. But before we get started today, one thing I think we need to get out of the way. First, for those of you not so familiar with this, make sure you get on Minty, minty.com. Put in that code 4772998. We're going to be asking questions throughout the Happy Hour. We need your feedback. This isn't just like a one-way conversation. We want to make this as conversational as possible as we can do on the internet. So please get to minty.com. Feel free to hit that heart button right below me once you get on minty.com. Again, the code to use is 4772998. It'll always be at the top of the slides. Now, before we get started, I think it'd be important to just mention, like acknowledge kind of our circumstances, right? We are in the middle of a global pandemic. Things are looking up, but they're not perfect. And we want to give you a minute to just get it out of your system. You know, before you have a good time here at the JSS Happy Hour, sometimes you got to get some things off your chest. Let us know how you're feeling. I'm going to put on some music to get us in the mood. Let me know how it's going, good, bad, indifferent. Just take a minute to get logged into Minty and let me know what's going on. Here's a song about dealing with adversity.
You know, sometimes we're not prepared for adversity. When it happens, sometimes we're caught short. We don't know exactly how to handle it when it comes up. Sometimes we don't know just what to do when adversity takes over. And I have advice for all of us. I got it from our pianist, Joe Zawinul, who wrote this tune. And it sounds like what you're supposed to say when you have that kind of problem. It's called mercy, mercy, mercy.
One thing I wanted to mention, we have a lot of people that are doing pretty good, and that's great to hear. Everybody's had a long week, I know. One thing I wanted to mention, somebody's mentioned they're lonely. I know the feeling. I'm here in a building all by myself, basically. Right after this happy hour, we will be hosting like a little hangout in Discord. You're more than welcome to join us. Just a great chance to, if you are feeling lonely and tired of only seeing your cat or whatever else is in your house with you, we're going to be hanging out in Discord. It's a fun place to hang out. And so please join us there. All right. And we are going to go ahead and get started. Thank you so much for joining us. This is the JSS Happy Hour. Let me introduce our panelists real quick. Here we go, switching over to the panelists. Panelists, make sure you're unmuted. Let's start off with Gustavo. Let us know what's going on. Well, thanks for joining us.
Hello, my pleasure. Thank you, David. Thank you all for coming. My name is Gustavo. I'm a professor here at the Federal University of Pará. And actually, I don't know why David in Paris invited me.
All right. Thanks, Gustavo. We invited you for the colorful commentary and the colorful headphones. Krista, let us know what's up.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Krista. I'm the professor of software engineering at University of California in Irvine. And I am up for a very all interesting events that happen online. I actually like them a lot. So I'm a big proponent of entirely virtual conferences too. You may have known me from seeing me around at ICSI. I was the virtualization chair there too. So happy to be here.
All right, thanks, Krista, also known as the Queen of Virtualization. Next up, we are obliged also to invite this next guy. I'll let him introduce himself.
So hi, everybody. I'm Paris. I'm a prof at the University of Groningen. I really believe that doing research should also be fun. So this is exactly the place to be. And I am here because I sort of invited myself. Thank you.
All right, thanks everybody. We're gonna be heading back to some videos now. Again, this is the JSS happy hour. Hope y'all are ready for some good research. And we're gonna go ahead and get started with our first video. Here we go. The format we're gonna have is we're gonna have a video. It's just a 3-minute video. Then we're gonna have the panelists comment, and then we might even have a question for y'all on Menti. So make sure you log into Menti if you haven't already. Here's our first video.
Hello to everyone attending the Journal of System and Software's Happy Hour, and thank you for attending this short presentation on the paper, The Long and Winding Road, MBSC Adoption for Functional Avionics of Spacecraft. My name is Joe Gregory, and this work has been undertaken with support from colleagues at the University of Bristol and Airbus Space. Together, the University and Airbus were interested in the application of model-based systems engineering techniques to the design, development, analysis, and validation of spacecraft functional avionics. We refer to this area as model-based avionics engineering. With many possible options and use cases to explore, this work was designed and undertaken in order to elicit the areas that would benefit the most from these model-based techniques from the perspective of Airbus engineers. Our research question, therefore, is: which model-based avionics engineering use cases would be most beneficial to Airbus engineers? To understand this, we took the following 4 stages of work. First, we designed a semi-structured interview as a way of generating responses from interviewees. Question 1 asked, what causes rework or non-quality in your projects? Question 2 asked, can this be resolved by the use of models? Then we held 9 interviews following this structure, including 25 engineers across 3 European Airbus space sites. We followed the method of thematic analysis to interpret and code the 205 responses that we received. And finally, we analysed this codified data to extract the key recurring themes. This generated a number of themes and sub-themes, which were then grouped into 4 application areas: organization modeling, early functional validation, communication and consistency, and the development of a template model framework. Since the publication of this research, we have used the 2 areas within the scope of our work, which are early functional validation and template model framework development, to launch the Spacecraft Early Analysis Model Project, an ongoing model development project that looks to address these issues. The method presented can also be tailored and reused in other organizations and other industries. So, thanks again to the Journal of Systems and Software for the invitation and to everyone for listening. Questions and feedback are welcome at the email address provided. Enjoy the rest of your happy hour.
All right, and next up, we're going to go ahead and take some comments from our panel. Our panel is coming right up. And take it away, panel.
Yeah, so if I can start, what I really liked about this paper is that it explores the problem in industrial practice before actually proceeding with the solution. This sounds a little bit straightforward, but especially for the field of model-based, model-driven software engineering, we do have the tendency to sort of jump into conclusions, to solutions, and then look for the problems to apply them. So it's more like having hammers and looking for nails. So I like that this study actually searches for use cases that are useful to engineers. And from the application areas that the authors presented, the one that resonated very well with me was this early functional validation, especially because I come from the field of architecture. Being able to identify faults early in the life cycle when it's still cheap and certainly relatively easy to fix them is of the utmost importance. So well done, guys.
Gustavo, you're muted.
Yeah, really nice paper, and sorry for being muted. So I was wondering, is avionics the next frontier in software engineering? It actually would be nice to see more papers on this domain. This paper is also a great example on how to do qualitative research, like how to do the interviews, how to analyze data, use semantic analysis, describe each stage of the process. Also, the limitations are very clear, and I think I agree with Paris, and this is actually one of strong candidates for the JSS paper of the year.
All right. Thanks a lot, Gustavo. And I think you have an interesting point, too, as I move back to the slides, about avionics potentially being a new hot topic in software engineering. There's obviously been some problems with avionics software here in the past few years, so that could be a really interesting future topic. I'd love to see more industrial topics like avionics and manufacturing and things like that in software engineering conferences. One thing we wanted to do is ask you guys and gals some questions throughout our talks here. The first one we have is, how can we help publicize JSS papers? So this is just the idea, you know, these papers are published in a journal. Of course, they're going to be automatically shown on the website and things like that, but how can we better help publicize your papers? You know, we want to help get them out there. We want to help, you know, people know about the great research that's going on. And we're trying to do things like the happy hour, but what other ideas do you have, and how can we just continue to do that? So I'm going to leave this slide up as we head on to video two. Thanks again for the good discussion panel. Here we go, video two in our happy hour. Again, you can continue to vote throughout this little session.
Welcome to this brief presentation of our paper, Exploring Onboarding Success, Organizational Fit, and Turnover Intention of Software Professionals. This work was done jointly with Gaurav Sharma, who is currently with IBM. The term onboarding can be interpreted in different ways. We can consider it to refer to developers becoming familiar with the code base. Relevant work in the software engineering literature includes techniques to understand legacy systems, information seeking, source code analysis, and feature location. In this study, however, we consider onboarding in a more traditional sense, which is a process by which individuals become part of an organization. Most of the work on onboarding software professionals represents field studies, which are conducted at specific organizations in concrete settings. While these field studies exhibit a high level of realism, they lack in generalizability. There are no theory development studies on this topic within the software engineering literature. We look at three key activities conducted common in onboarding programs and link them to onboarding success. We then link onboarding success to two dimensions of what we call organizational fit, job satisfaction and workplace relationship quality. We then argue that a better organizational fit reduces people's intentions to leave. Our theoretical model consists of so-called latent variables, which are not directly measurable, and so we use measurement instruments for each latent variable. Using a convenient sample of 102 responses, we test the model using PLS-SEM. The findings of our study can be summarized as follows. Of the onboarding activities, support is by far the most important. Onboarding success links to both job satisfaction and to workplace relationship quality. While job satisfaction links to lower levels of turnover intention, the quality of a person's relationships within the workplace does not. Onboarding success doesn't mean people won't leave. Instead, focus on keeping employees happy.
Okay, I thought this was a really interesting paper. And I think this is something that it comes to my mind that it would be something to study even more, in particular when it comes to diversity and inclusion. I think that a lot of these studies, the few studies that exist on onboarding and, you know, making people be part of a team, tend to focus just on sort of the majority, on averages and things like that. But it would be interesting to see and to design studies to try to figure out how do you, you know, make people that are by nature and by design that are different from the norm, and they are not the same kind of people that you have been always hiring. So that would be an interesting follow-up study for this paper, I would think.
I think that's a great point, Krista. I know the authors are very strong in empirical research, and I appreciated the motivation that they gave. We do see a lot of field studies that have a bit of limited external validity, so we do need more theory development. And so I applaud the authors for proposing a theory. I actually found the end result quite interesting. So if you're happy with your work, you can stay in the organization. But even if you have high quality relations, you might not stay there. So I think that's a good takeaway. You know what to do now if you want to keep people in the organization or maybe push them out.
Great, and thanks, panel. And also in the comments, Alexander is saying he used the schema in his course this year, which I think might be an interesting thing to chat about in Discord afterwards if we get a chance. Going back to the presentation, you can see the results coming in for helping to publicize JSS papers. We're going to use these, of course, to help improve JSS. So I just wanted to share the results with you. And again, we just saw video 2. Now, we wanted to also ask y'all a question. How would you suggest we improve reviews? That's something we're going to try and improve here in the next, you know, year. We really want to continue to improve reviews. So get your typing fingers ready. Go ahead and let us know how you think we should improve reviews in JSS. Give you just a minute to get that in before we start the next video. And we're starting to see some responses come in. Meta reviews where editors take perhaps more responsibility or get more involved and resolve conflicting reviews. That's a great idea. Using some guidelines like the SIGSOFT guideline. Asking reviewers to provide reviews of some kind of, absolute length. Absolutely, you would think that people would be professional enough to do that, but yeah, that's not always true, of course. Paying reviewers, one of the more controversial, I'm all for it. Let's see if we can convince the powers to be to do it. I think blacklisting is a really interesting comment we're getting, and we don't have an official blacklist yet, but that is something that we've definitely seen is somebody that gives a one-line review. Let's phrase it more positively. Somebody that doesn't give a one-line review, always doesn't give a one-line review. It's people that give one-line reviews are definitely more likely to give other one-line reviews. So we definitely avoid those types of reviewers. All right, I'm going to allow you, of course, to continue to putting in these inputs during the next video. Next up, we got our third video in the happy hour. Take it away.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dalia Sobhi. I'm one of the main authors of this research project, which is Runtime Evaluation of Architectures, a Case Study of Diversification in Internet of Things. First, we have found that the current software architectures, such as Internet of Things, are characterized by scalability, dynamicity, and heterogeneity, and that the current architecture evaluation methods cannot tackle these uncertainties alone. So, in short, the limitation of design time approaches are low confidence in the estimates given by the experts, partial anticipation in the benefits of the options over time, and the estimates may change over time. The main problem our research aims to address is the lack of a systematic software architecture evaluation framework that interwins and interleaves design time evaluation with runtime evaluation. To motivate our research, we have used iTransport, which is an urban traffic monitoring system. It uses fixed and mobile cameras to capture the traffic, provides two functionalities, online analytics and offline analytics. And we mainly aim to evaluate the balance between the benefit in terms of these quality of services and the cost. So our approach or our framework complements design time evaluation and runtime evaluation to handle uncertainties. First, by tracking the benefits of the options over time, alerting the architect in case of significant changes, and finally evaluating the cost-benefit trade-offs of the architecture options. This is the framework. The first part is already published in ICSA, and the second part is the JSS paper, which first evaluates the current architecture options, detects significant changes, and finally selects another architecture option if the current option is not working well. To evaluate our approach, we have used the case study application, which is iTransport, controlled the experiment. We have tested our approach against different quality of service concerns, when the response time is a concern, when the energy consumption is a concern, and so forth. We compared our approach against baseline and state-of-the-art approaches, tested it for different monitoring intervals, noise levels, and scalability. To conclude, our approach provides a visual demonstration of the benefit of the options, continuous assessment of design time decisions at runtime, guidelines for the architect on how to apply our approach, provide smarter decisions in case there is no enough info about the architecture options, if these options are not always available, and so forth. It is robust to noise, scalable, and also outperformed the baseline approaches such as the static design time approaches and random approaches. There are some potential future directions for our research, which is exploring the forecasting ability of the benefit of the options, testing the impact of high price volatility, and finally, the further use of simulator along with the running system. Thank you. We hope that you have enjoyed our talk.
Right, and thank you. As I head right over to the panelists, take it away, panelists.
Well, if I may start, I think the Internet of Things domain certainly has a lot of challenges in the runtime behavior. Because of the existence of uncertainty. So we have a lot of sources of uncertainty that we can simply not predict at design time. And I love what the authors proposed, having this kind of runtime evaluation to tackle uncertainty by reconfiguring your system, which means to change your design decisions at runtime, is the right way to go. And by the way, I know that this is a really hot topic in the community of self-adaptive systems, so I really hope they're watching this.
Right, so I liked the video. I definitely like to work in the Internet of Things. It's definitely a hot topic these days. So if I could just say a little further feedback to the authors, in respect to the video, I think I would have liked to see a little bit more of the actual findings, like what can we take from here? Like how can we use this work to design IoT systems, right? So that's what I think would be very interesting to come out of the this particular video. And I'm pretty sure that the authors have those lessons. So today, it is more interesting to kind of make them all a bit more visible.
All right, great. And I just wanted to remind y'all that we will be having some chats in Discord after, so it might be a good place. And I will send the link to Discord at the end of the happy hour. It might be a good place to hang out and chat a bit about some of these papers, especially the ones that you're most interested in. Now we're going to open it up. Just a question to y'all as authors. Put on your author's hat and let us know, what can we try and do for you as authors? Of course, we can't offer you the world, but we do want to do our best to keep you happy as our customers here at JSS. So please let us know what you think we can do to help improve the author experience, your experience as author at JSS. I'll give you guys and gals just a minute before we head on to the next video and get in your comments and questions. And again, I will, of course, send this, keep this open during the next video. And a question that I'm seeing in the chat, I just want to answer real quick, is Discord is where we're going to go to hang out afterwards. It's just a cool kind of like easy way to hang out, kind of like Slack, but more social. And it has video chat. That's what we'll be using, video chat. And it has virtual rooms, and we will just be doing a virtual coffee break right after this. So with that, I'm going to head on to video number 4 in our coffee break. Feel free to continue to give us feedback on this. And here we go.
Hello, everybody. In this paper, we looked at teamwork in undergraduate software engineering group projects, aiming to compare the expectations team have at the beginning of a group project with the way they perceive the reality of teamwork once the project is completed. In a nutshell, the group project is run as part of a 27-week undergraduate module. Students work in teams of 5 or 6 students and develop a medium-sized software application, submitting monthly deliverables. The last deliverable is a 3-page retrospective account of the project where each team discusses the development process followed, how this process matched the initial plan for the project, the main challenges faced, and some of the lessons learned. 35 teams were involved in the study. At the start of the project, we collected data on the students' experience with teamwork and on their expectations for previously reported breakdown scenarios to occur as part of this project. The results show that first, students relate to teamwork, but they do not necessarily relate teamwork with software development. Also, they do not perceive recurring breakdown scenarios reported in previous years as a real risk for their own projects. Additionally, we found no significant correlation between the way students rated the likelihood of the breakdown scenarios and the number of software development projects they reported to have been involved in. We used the grounded theory to analyze the 35 retrospectives, and most teams discussed the team's experience and the role of meetings in their project. 40% of the teams discussed the role leadership or lack of played in their project. Team environment was also discussed by several teams, where they identified both characteristics that helped and some that made the experience more difficult for team members. There was not much discussion around themes such as conflict resolution or approaches for monitoring progress throughout the 27 weeks. We analyzed how the expectations students had at the beginning of the year matched the realities they described in the retrospective accounts. For this, we identified the top 15% most recurring codes used in the thematic analysis of the retrospectives. All but one of the initial breakdown scenarios were identified in this top 15%.
All right, and this one for me particularly is really relevant. I'm dealing with the end of a software engineering course right now. It's really interesting to hear their experiences. Go ahead and take it away, panel.
Yeah, if I can start, this is actually very interesting for all of us that teach software engineering courses. And actually, this is another well-done qualitative work, and this paper has many interesting takeaways. But the one that I like the most is to emphasize the importance of leadership for students, because they don't pay much attention with leadership in the group projects, although this is a very important skill in the industry. So the next time that you run a group project, don't forget to assign a group leader.
Yeah, I really agree with you, Gustavo. Actually, I was smiling when I was watching this, and the slide said that students at the beginning of the course, they didn't find the risks as relevant. And then at the end, these same risks became very prominent for all of the student groups. I think it's a good sign, actually, that students are learning the realities of software development. And if we look closely at these realities, the human and social aspects, not just leadership, as Gustavo mentioned, but the other aspects like the team environment, these are the dominant factors. And that is exactly what we should be teaching our students.
Great. And yeah, there's some really interesting comments in the chat too. Make sure you're following the chat and feel free to just add to the chat discussion. We are going to head on to our next video now. This is number 5 in our JSS Happy Hour. Check it out.
Welcome. I am Francisco Gomez, and I'll now share how my co-authors and I looked at the evolution of statistical analysis in empirical software engineering. Now, researchers use statistical methods to check whether the results are statistically significant and then ascertain if those results indicate practical significance of a tool, method, or technique that they're proposing. So in our paper, we investigated how have researchers been using statistical analysis in empirical and quantitative software engineering research over the years. We also looked at what should they be careful about when doing statistical analysis, and if they really use the statistical results to support practical significance in their papers. We answered those questions by doing a semi-automatic extraction and analysis of the statistical methods reported in 15 years of empirical software engineering research. That resulted in a sample of over 5,000 papers from 5 high-impact journals in our field. In the paper, you will find all detailed trends and results, in which we see an overall increase in usage of statistical methods like non-parametric tests and effect size measures. However, considering the main methods of a researcher's statistical toolkit, we see some contrasting results here in our bubble chart. For instance, there is a clear increase in the usage of parametric tests like t-test or ANOVA over the years, which rely on the assumptions about the distribution and scale of the data used by those tests. Yet, we do not see a corresponding increase in the usage of distribution tests, which are important and needed to check those assumptions. We compile our findings into guidelines and a workflow model to help researchers distinguish the elements of statistical inference and how that connects to practical significance, which is dependent of a practitioner's view, and then support future research via reproducibility. So after all, what is the practical significance of our paper? Well, if you're writing a paper, we provide tools, information, and insights that help you refine and improve your statistical analysis. If you are a reviewer, then you can actually use our guidelines to check the correctness of a statistical analysis done by the papers that you review. And if you're just a researcher or practitioner reading papers, well, you can see examples of how the statistical analysis of a paper should be connected to practical significance. In fact, in a follow-up study, we proposed the combination of Bayesian data analysis and prospect theory to bridge statistical analysis and decision-making in software engineering. I suggest you check that out. Thank you for listening, and take care.
All right, very cool paper, very relevant. I've definitely bookmarked that, and there is an open access link in the chat. Take it away, panel.
Yeah, so I'm definitely sending this to my students. I think over the years, I've heard a number of software engineering researchers shouting from the rooftops, urging our community to make proper use of statistical analysis. And according to this paper, we do not quite listen to them. So this example that's also in the chat about the number of parametric tests increasing significantly but the number of distribution tests not. I think that paints a clear picture. We need to do our statistics homework better. And I'm grateful to the authors for conveying this message and also for providing with some practical guidelines for us on how to do so.
Right, so what I could say, I think that was one of the best videos of this JSS happy hour. And Francisco, I noticed that you're online, so you are a terrific speaker, so congratulations. And by the way, this paper is actually a must read for anyone doing software engineering empirical work. And yeah, go grab your copy. I already have mine.
All right. Thanks very much, guys and gals. Next up, we're going to have a brief but important commercial break. I'm going to go ahead first, though, and let Paris tell us just a little bit about this.
Okay, thanks, Dave. So Dave and I have been thinking of ways to sort of improve the peer review process. I know we all complain about this, and it's not an easy problem to solve. So we were very happy to see this initiative from ACM Sigsoft, the one that we're going to show the commercial about. And we're going to work together with the leader of this initiative, Paul Rolf, to roll out a pilot of using empirical standards to improve the peer review process within JSS. And since we want to eat our own dog food, we plan to empirically validate how well those empirical standards work. So stay tuned and enjoy the commercial.
Here we go.
The time has come to fundamentally redesign peer review to improve its fairness, inclusiveness, transparency, and effectiveness. The secret to this redesign is developing empirical standards. Today, when a scholar peer reviews a manuscript, they must simultaneously generate and apply a set of evaluation criteria. The problem is that generating an appropriate rubric for judging research quality is mind-numbingly difficult, so reviewers tend to generate incomplete, oversimplified, and inappropriate criteria. It's not because reviewers are stupid, it's because no one person can generate good rubrics for all of the different kinds of studies SE researchers review. Furthermore, the reviewers, the editor, and the authors may construct totally different rubrics, and these rubrics may depart wildly from published methodological guidance or the norms of their scientific community. Most frustration with the peer review process comes from authors and reviewers disagreeing on what makes a study good. The power imbalance between authors and reviewers makes correcting some reviewers impossible. We need to change the process so that reviewers all use the right criteria in the first place. The solution is for the software engineering community to decide together what good means. For each common methodology, we create a one-page checklist of specific expectations. To prevent reviewers from using the standards in an inflexible, gotcha-like manner, each criterion is paired with a simple decision tree. When a reviewer indicates that a criterion is not satisfied, they will be explicitly asked whether there is a good reason. Providing the same specific criteria to authors and reviewers will improve research quality, simplify reviewing, reduce conflict, and increase acceptance rates. For more information about the Empirical Standards Project, please sign up for our upcoming webinar and check out the preliminary report on our GitHub repo.
All right, and thanks so much, Paul. It's really interesting to hear it right from your mouth, and I think this is a really important one that we might want to have a little bit of a discussion in Discord. So again, for those of you that want to stick around and hang out afterwards, Paul will be here. We can discuss in Discord right after. And of course, free to discuss it in the chat. I think this is a good topic for us all to discuss. Next up, we're going to move on to the super well-produced next video. I want you to check it out all the way from Norway. Here we go.
Before presenting our paper, I would like to tell you where I am now. I am in north of Europe, Norway, Trondheim, one of the biggest cities in Norway. We are now inside the Norwegian University of Science and Technology that I want to thank. And I want to thank the Research Council of Norway for sponsoring especially two projects that are very important for my research and the research of my group, one being the IDUN project that looks into gender issue in research, and the other one being the IPIT project that is a cooperation between two universities in China, one university in US, and our university, the Norwegian University of Science and Technology. So this piece of research started in late summer 2017 when two students knocked at my door and they wanted to work in software startups. And then the two students and Anne get a very good connection with each other, and the focus changed from software startup to a hardware startup.
So it was a really interesting and a pleasant time to work with the students and also in this team. So we think about hardware in the context of smart systems like sensors, gateways, connectivity components, or standalone wearable device. So they have a close connection to the software, and hardware and software together, they make one complete systems.
Because all the time in this work, we have tried to look to put together the two concepts of fast development, reacting to change that is important for the startup, and long cycle development that is important for quality-driven work. Helped by us, they developed an interview guide that is divided into four parts, and they interviewed 13 persons who have a big role in 13 hardware startups.
You can see what we can observe quite clearly here is that the hardware startups lack both strategies and mindset for achieving the long-term quality of the product.
Thank you, Anne. I think you explain it very, very well. See you on Monday, Anne, and thank you for this nice adventure.
Have a nice weekend, Leticia.
Ciao, bye-bye, bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, and before I head over to the panel, thanks again for just the production quality for a lot of you guys on making these videos. It really makes it a lot more enjoyable and easy to get the really core message of the videos. Great work. Take it away, panel.
Yeah, I think I give this one the award for best production. Can I give awards? I just decided that I can give awards. Congratulations, this was a really nice video. And I think that, you know, the paper is quite interesting, the kind of the empirical observations that they got out of the surveys for, I think, inform, the future startups with respect to things like quality assurance and things like that. As a follow-up, I think it would be interesting to contrast the results that they got from this set of startups with a possible other set of startups that are focused more on software, whether there are, you know, there's exactly the same findings, and whether there's some significant differences between the findings, whether the companies focus on hardware or on software.
Yeah, let me first agree with giving this video the best presentation. It was very professionally done. So I like the perspective that this paper highlights, because in our field, we're used to this software startups that are very fast moving, very agile. But in the hardware world, you know, you have quality constraints, much harder quality constraints. So I would actually recommend the viewers to download and read this paper, because they didn't show it in the video, but they have a lot of practical advice on how to balance agility with quality. I personally appreciated one finding, which is close to my heart, the fact that technical debt is inevitable, even in these systems, in the hardware systems. And they just advise practitioners to accept this as a fact and try to manage their technical debt.
All right, and thanks again, panel. Next up, our seventh video in Happy Hour. We have a total of 9. So take it away.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to my video. In this video, I will provide a short introduction of our JSS paper entitled On Tracking Java Methods with Git Mechanisms. First of all, I will talk about the difference between file tracking and method tracking with Git. By using Git, we can track the history of files in Git repositories. In this example, we can see that a.java was changed twice to fix bugs in the past. On the other hand, in histories, which is a special version of Git repository, each method in Java source files has been extracted as a file. This means we can track Java method by using Git mechanisms. For example, we can easily know how many times a given method was changed by using git log commands. Git has a function that detects renamed files. In the default setting, if more than 60% of lines in file A are the same as file B, Git regards that A was changed to B. This function is very useful because information before the renaming can be retrieved. But this function is not good with small files, which is a research motivation. Here is an example of refactorings. In this example, file name, class name, field name, and method names have been changed to more appropriate ones. Since there are a few lines of changes for the entire file, the file can be tracked by Git mechanism. Next, let's see the case of histories where each method has been extracted as a file. In this case, since there are many lines of changes for the entire files, the files cannot be tracked by Git mechanisms. Here is our key idea to this problem. It's very simple. Let's increase the number of lines, which means placing only a single token on each line. In the case that we use this idea, since there are a few lines of changes for the entire files, the files can be tracked by a Git mechanism. Of course, we have also proposed some heuristics to realize better method tracking, but due to time limitation, I cannot talk about them. If you get interested in this research, please read our paper. It's an open access. We have evaluated FinerGit, which is our technique from many aspects. Here shows some paragraph in this paper. We confirmed that FinerGit's F-measure was better than HistReg's one, and Git was able to detect more renames with FinerGit than HistReg. And FinerGit worked well for methods of any size. In spite of that, our research motivation was to realize better tracking for small methods. That's all. Thank you very much for your attention.
All right, and thanks. I'm going to hand it right over to the panel.
Yeah, this is another interesting study, how to improve Git to cover small code chains, right? I see many ways in which I could take advantage of this approach and this tool to do other works like assessing bug introducing changes or detecting code authorship in a more fine-grained way. Another great thing about this paper is that the tool is already available on GitHub. I actually tried this tool yesterday and it's working. My only comment, if the authors are here, if possible, could please translate part of the documentation, which is in Japanese, to English. Thank you.
Yeah, this is definitely one of the papers that I am going to download and read and give to my students. I think there's lots of interesting opportunities to use version tracking to more than just the traditional way that we have been using it, which is sort of the file level. This work, it uses it more at the method level, and I think it kind of changes the capabilities of the you know, version tracking. So it would be interesting to see how it changes even the developers' processes when they're developing, when you have a source control tool that works at the finite granularity. So I thought it was really interesting, and I'm glad to see that there is a tool out there that we can actually try.
All right, and after this question, we do have a quick question that we wanted to post to y'all as we start this next video, and that the question is this: what is the number one issue in scientific publishing today, according to you? So let us know what you think. I'm going to keep this up. We'll show this just briefly afterwards as we move on to our eighth video. Again, we have a total of nine, and then we're going to head over to Discord. Take it away.
Hello, my name is Carlos Gaviria, a PhD graduate from University College London. Today, I will present the paper we published last year at the Journal of Systems and Software. Software development is still a human-intensive enterprise. People involved in it have different interests, and they are not necessarily aligned with organization goals. What is worse, the organization's software development process can be the cause of this misalignment. The XE paper featured in the slide illustrates one of these situations. It studies an organization whose development process favored feature delivery over code quality. It mentions a software issue affecting the work of 12 teams at different times. Given the incentives in place, the 12 teams developed temporary workarounds. Collectively, they invested 60 person days. In contrast, building a permanent fix could be significantly cheaper, requiring only 20 person days. We believe many software processes suffer from such incentive problems. We propose to use game theory to identify such problematic processes, to then improve them by aligning their incentive to the organization's needs. In this slide, we're using a payoff table to represent the scenario we just described. It models two players, the developers, that interact via two actions. The fix intensive action favors fixes. They take more time, keep a healthy code base, and are unlikely to require rework. In contrast, the clutch intensive action favors clutches. They are faster, degrade code base quality, and are rework prone. A table cell contains the player's payoff given their actions. In this case, it is the expected number of features released. The equilibrium analysis of this model can predict player behavior. For this payoff table, it outputs that both developers adopt the clutch intensive action. However, if incentive favored an equilibrium with the fixed intensive action, the team would have released two additional features. To enable game theoretic models to scale, we adopted empirical game theoretic analysis, or EGTA. EGTA abstractions are payoff tables with payoff values obtained via simulation. We start by building and validating a simulation model of the process to improve. Using this model, we can experiment with interventions to see the effect they have in equilibrium behavior. In the slide, we see the simulation model of a process that moves equilibrium towards the fixed intensive action. By including code analysis and code review, we made clutches more expensive and less attractive to developers. Thank you very much for listening, and I invite you to read our paper.
All right, and thank you for introducing game theory into a software engineering context. Take it away, panel.
So the authors mentioned technical debt, which means I have to say something here. I really appreciate this problem that the authors address. So the way that developers make decisions where they have to balance their own incentives against the needs of the organizations is a classic one. In fact, this is the typical technical debt dilemma. Do you favor clean code or do you favor feature delivery? And I think the authors sort of hit the nail here by using game theory. While the results of the simulation that they showed, things like using code review and code analysis to favor fixing are not really surprising, but they are certainly actionable. Finally, I suggest to make the term clutch intensive development a standard term in our field.
Yeah, I completely agree with Paris. This paper is actually a great example on how to use game theory in software engineering work. Although it's not the first one, this group is doing a lot of great work with game theory. I think this is the third paper that they are publishing along these lines. This paper also contributes to this empirical game theory analysis area of the research with might be something to keep your eye open in the future. And since this paper is authored by Mark Harmon, it wouldn't be a surprise that this would become a hot topic in the future.
All right, and thanks again, panel. I'm moving back to the presentation so y'all can check out some of the results of the number one issues in scientific publishing. Of course, pressure to publish comes up very strongly. There's lots of interesting feedback here, which I'll probably post a screenshot of this after the talk. One thing that I'm amused by is that it is not clean. Not sure what that means, but we've got all kinds of interesting feedback here. Maybe they're talking about ethically not clean. All right, next up, we're going to go ahead and move to our final video for the day. You guys and gals have all made it through. Lots of you still here with us. And after this, again, we're going to be moving to Discord. Here we go, the last video in JSS's happy hour for today.
Hi, and welcome to this short presentation on our paper, Are Unit Integration Test Definitions Still Valid for Modern Java Projects, an Empirical Study in Open Source Projects? My name is Stefan Herbold, and this is joint work with Fabian Trautsch and Jens Kabowski. Our motivation for our work was basically the many different opinions regarding unit integration tests in developer communities, and also with researchers. So there are people in favor of unit tests, people in favor of integration tests, people who say test, we don't care how, but there's not really empirical evidence. And then the research side, it's even worse. We have textbooks that basically say there are big differences between unit integration tests, especially regarding the kinds of defects we find, but really, we also have no empirical evidence about this. So we set out to collect this empirical evidence and answer this one central research question. Are unit or integration tests more effective in certain types of program defects? So can we find a difference between these two types of tests regarding their defect detection capabilities? Our approach was quite simple. We wanted to collect real-world tests, classify them into unit integration tests, use mutation testing as proxy to analyze the defect detection capabilities, and then run some statistics. We implemented all of this in the comfort framework, which enables us to put in a project release, determine the tests, including their types, determine the mutation scores for the different types of defects for the different tests, also determine how large the tests are, and put everything into our statistical analysis. And for the 9,000 unit tests, 29,000 integration tests, and over 600,000 unique mutations, we could not really find any statistically significant differences. We found some smaller differences, but nothing that really mattered. So what does this mean? First of all, unit integration tests are not really that different in terms of the defect detection capabilities. It more depends on whether the unit and integration tests are well designed or not. We found that unit tests might be a bit better at finding difficult defects, but the findings were very weak and not conclusive. So what should we do, both as practitioners and researchers? Well, both sides should stop preaching in favor of unit or integration tests or regarding the differences. Instead, everybody should just use what fits the purpose. So you want to write a unit test, write a unit test. You want to write an integration test, write the integration test. And the researchers and standardization organizations should probably consider updating the definitions. So thank you for watching this short presentation. Here's my contact info. And if you want to know more about the differences between unit integration tests, please look up Fabian Crouch, PhD thesis behind this QR code.
Right, and thanks, Stefan. I think I've seen you around in the chat. It's very cool to have an author attending and actively, you know, engaged in discussion. We really appreciate that. Take it away, panel.
So I like this paper. I like the question of this paper. I think it's important for us as a field in general to revisit certain things that I've taken for granted for many years and decades and kind of try to ask them, you know, be bold enough to ask whether that is still true and go and find out whether it's true or not and whether we need to change the things that the way that we thought about that particular concept. So in that respect, this is a really interesting paper that basically lifts that stone and takes an interesting look with a solid methodology to come to the conclusion that you know, perhaps it doesn't matter so much. So let's not pay so much attention to the semantic differences between the two things, and perhaps focus more on explaining people, you know, that they should use whatever tool they have to achieve the goals that they think are important in their project.
Right, yeah, I completely agree with Krista. By the way, I think this paper is one of the most comprehensive studies on unit tests and integration, with thousands of test cases investigated. I think this paper has many interesting finds, but perhaps the most interesting one is that unit testing and integration testing can find some similar kind of defects, like interface defects. And this is interesting because it contradicts the belief that you should use unit tests for this and integration tests for that. That being said, I think the next question for future work is, what kind of testing approach should we use, since we can find similar defects with both of them?
All right, and I have just posted also the open access link to this paper right in the chat for you to follow up on, check it out. Also, of course, there is all the open access links in that playlist. So that brings us to the official end of our JSS happy hour. Thank you guys and gals for joining us. However, for those of you that have a few more minutes and you want to hang out, a lot of us are heading right over to Discord. This is the same Discord that we used in FSE. They've been nice enough to just let us use this as well. So a lot of you might already be members of this Discord. All we're going to do is head on over to Discord, and you can see Coffee Break 1, 2, 3, 4, Hallway Track, Small Talk, Students Only, all kinds of rooms right here. These are voice chat rooms and also video chat rooms. Make sure you turn your video on if you want to hang out here. And a little tip for those of you that are new to Discord, you can see who's in each room so you can avoid Paris. But also, if there's 20 people in one room, maybe you go to the next room because a chat with 20 people gets to be a little hectic. You know, try and keep it to small groups of five or so so that we all have a chance to talk. PhDs love to talk, as you know. And again, thank you guys and gals for joining us for the happy hour. Head over to Discord. Hope you've had a great time and have a great rest of your Friday and a great weekend. Talk to y'all later.
Some nights I stay up, cashing in my bad luck. Some nights I call it a draw. Some nights I wish that my lips could build a castle. Some nights I wish they just fall off. But I still wake up, I still see a gospel. Lord, I'm still not sure what I stand for. What do I stand for? What do I stand for? Most nights I don't know anymore.
Some nights I always win.
And just a reminder, that link is in the chat. We are heading over to Discord now. I will see anyone that wants to hang out there. Hope you all have a great weekend. And take it easy.